Governor Roy Cooper has, since the early part of 2020, used the state's Emergency Management Act to impose restrictions on our movement, restrictions on business, commerce, all sorts of things. Now, our next guest is very concerned about the governor's muscular reliance on this law, not only now, but for the precedent this could actually set for future governors. Jon Guze is Director of Legal Studies for the John Locke Foundation. He joins us now with a look at the issue of the power of government. John, welcome back to the program.
Thank you, Donna.
One person essentially controlling the lives of more than 10 million people. It seems like an idea that you really don't want to buy into, no matter who that person is, Democrat, Republican.
Certainly not. It's the very definition of tyranny. That's the whole reason we have a separation of powers under our federal constitution and emphatically under our North Carolina constitution. The governor ordinarily doesn't have the power to make these rules. That power lies with the General Assembly the way it should. It's a legislative power, not an executive power.
So the Emergency Management Act is the issue here and how it's being interpreted by Governor Cooper. He is saying that it gives him the right to make all these decisions in a situation that is out of the ordinary. And we're talking about the COVID-19 pandemic. What is your read of that of the Emergency Management Act?
Well, this is an act. There's similar acts in every state. It does seem to make sense, on its face at least, to give the governor some extraordinary powers in an actual emergency to make and enforce orders without going through the whole legislative process. That's what emergency powers acts are for, and that's what our act is for. But you don't want to give them unchecked powers, and it's important that any good, well-crafted emergency act provide those kinds of checks. Now, ours is particularly good because in North Carolina, we have something called the Council of State. We don't have a unitary executive the way many states do. Executive power in the state is dispersed over 10 different executive officers, each of whom is elected by the people.
These are all the statewide elected officials, agriculture commissioner, lieutenant governor, those types of positions.
That's right. And because they come from more than one party, they're pretty equally divided right now between the Democrats and Republicans, because they hail from different parts of the state and because each of them is elected by the people. That's an important check on executive power. So what we've got in our Emergency Power Act is a provision that says, yes, the governor can declare an emergency. Yes, he has certain standard powers, but he also has extraordinary powers that he could exercise with the concurrence of the Council of State. When he issued his very first one of these lockdown orders, the one that closed the bars and restaurants, he actually sought approval from the Council of State, and he claimed in the order itself that he had obtained it, but in fact he hadn't. Six members refused to go along with this order, and he went ahead anyway. And he claimed he could do that because there's a separate provision that pertains to local authorities and their powers. They have their own set of powers. And in that provision, it's section 1930C, it says that if the governor finds that local control is insufficient to deal with the emergency, he can exercise another set of powers. And so now, ever since that first order, he's been relying on those powers under 30C. The problem there is that if all he has to do is simply say, oh, well, local control is insufficient, then he's got unlimited powers and he doesn't need the Council of State. I don't think that can be the right interpretation, but that's the interpretation he's taking.
Here's what I find curious, John. If initially Governor Cooper did go to the Council of State to try to get their approval, doesn't that indicate to you by his actions that his own administration's view is that he wanted and needed their approval?
Well, yes. I mean, if you read that first order, that's very clear that that's how he thought this is supposed to work. And he's just changed his position ever since because he couldn't get the approval that he wanted.
It was interesting as well that the current Lieutenant Governor, Dan Forrest, who at the time was challenging Governor Cooper for the governor's seat, Dan Forrest, of course, lost that race. Governor Roy Cooper will serve a second term. But that was an important issue to Lieutenant Governor Dan Forrest. And didn't he challenge that legally?
He did. He filed a lawsuit saying that all these orders were illegal because they were issued without Council of State concurrence. He took it a good deal of the way, but when he got a first adverse ruling from a court, not on the merits of his complaint itself, but simply on his request for an emergency or a temporary injunction to stop enforcement, when the court ruled against him there, he just dropped the suit, which was, I thought, very disappointing.
So the General Assembly, the legislature, makes the laws in the state. Does that mean then, John, that the General Assembly could take this up and amend this act to make it very clear that one person doesn't have sole control?
They could, and in my opinion, they should. Of course, if they do it in the next session, likely outcome is that the governor will just veto it. But they might be able to, if they have any sense, the members of both parties will see that this is a case of the governor usurping their legitimate powers under the Constitution. I would think at least some Democrats might see that that's not what we want. They might override a veto. And even if they don't, we just have to start the process. Sooner or later, I think we'll get to the point where our governor will go along with this. It's because it's obviously what we needed. That's not the only thing that's wrong with the Emergency Management Act.
What else?
Well, one of the biggest problems that I see with it is open-ended. Most states' emergency management acts have a time limit, 30 days in some cases, 90 days in some others. But at some point, the governor has to go to the legislature and say, I need you to extend my powers. They don't just allow the governor to go on acting like a tyrant or a dictator or a king indefinitely. There's a fixed limit on the duration of his powers. Our act doesn't have that, and I think we need to add it. I think that's very important.
I wonder about the precedent that's being set here, John, because let's say it's a future governor. Maybe it's a governor I agree with. Maybe it's a governor I disagree with. But let's say that he or she decides that climate change is the emergency that is occurring in North Carolina, or it's another public health issue. Maybe it's the flu or something we don't even know about yet. Aren't we really setting ourselves up here for people in that position feeling that, well, Roy Cooper did it, so I'm going to do it too?
I think we absolutely are setting ourselves up for that. That's exactly the prospect we've got ahead of us. All over the country, in fact, governors have clearly been relishing all these extensive powers, and it's going to be hard for them, I think, to relinquish them once the pandemic is over. I'm hoping that not just in North Carolina, but all over the country, steps will be taken to rein in these powers so that we don't end up in this situation again where governors can just exercise tyrannical powers unchecked.
In fact, you have been writing about the fact that it is the burden of government to illustrate to the people that this is necessary at this time. Talk a little bit more, if you would, John, about the relationship between the governed and the government.
Well, our country was founded on what I call the presumption of liberty. All else being equal, people should be free to do, to act, to think, to talk, and to act as they please without government interference. Anytime the government wants to interfere through regulation and other kinds of directives on how people behave, the burden is on the government to prove that this is an important interest at stake here, that this is the most efficient and least restrictive way to accomplish what needs to be done, and so forth. Unfortunately, courts have stopped enforcing that the way they should, but I'm hoping it'll make a comeback.